bit of free time, and I've asked Craig to take a couple of Q&A, questions and answers. So let's, who has the first question for Craig?
Okay, I know about customer service. I work for the major grocery store chain in Florida. You can guess which one.
The biggest one, I guess, is Publix. I'm sorry.
Good. You got something out for you. Yay! But the main thing I ask is, the thing I can get
hold on to the microphone.
Okay, the thing I'm asking about is, the one organization, one government group I see that's the biggest problem is EPA.
EPA?
EPA. I mean, the EPA is 10 billion wasted every year.
Yep.
Well,
how can we do it? Okay. Now, question is, are you going to go into Washington and say, it's time to close you guys down? Or are you going to go to Washington and have all these people happy talk to you and say, oh, let's be green. Oh, let's be happy.
Well, you can tell that I'm a happy person. I'm not a very green person. But government is too big. Whether it's the EPA or whether it's the IRS or where we spend our money, we have to reprioritize all of our government spending. It starts with making sure that we meet all of the commitments that we've already made. You know, the government seems to make promises and promises and promises. And then when they run out of money, they start backtracking on their promises. Well, there are certain things that I would never do, and that would be, A, I would never take any of the benefits that have been earned by the seniors in our country. My mom is 91 years old. She would be very unhappy if I couldn't make any impact on her Medicare benefits. When you make a promise to someone and a contract with them, you live up to it. That's the American way, okay? I will also always support our veterans. As a war veteran myself, I fought in an unpopular war. We owe that to our veterans to make sure that they're taken care of if they need be. What we need to do is reprioritize most of what's going on discretionary-wise in our federal government, and we've got to cut the spending. Until we do that, we're not going to reignite our economy, and we can't do it on the back of taxpayers. Thank you.
I have two questions for you. The first question is, will you stand with Israel? And the second question is, do you know and understand what Agenda 21 is and what a terrible threat it is to this country?
You know, sometimes things kind of sneak up on you, okay? The 21 has snuck up on the American people. This initiative through the United Nations that's threatening the under fabric of our country needs to be exposed, and I applaud many of the folks in this room, particularly people from the Tea Party and the 9/12 groups, the Patriot groups, that have exposed this in terms of what is going on, what it's doing, how it's infiltrated itself over the last 20 years into our local and city governments, and I applaud you for doing that. It needs to be stopped. The first thing to do is to expose the motivation and what the impact of that's going to have on our lives long term. The second question, the first question you asked. I will always stand with Israel. My partner at Pizzeria Uno, a fellow by the name of Aaron Spencer, I sat next to him for 17 years. He came from an Orthodox Jewish family in Boston. Israel is the best defense we have. They are the best friends that America has. We will always, if I have anything to say about it, they are key to defending what's going on in the Middle East. And the current activities that have gone on in the last 3 years that I think have undermined the relationship that our country has had with Israel for decades needs to stop. I will always be a supporter of Israel. I have never been to Israel, and I am ashamed to say that. I will be going to Israel as soon as I can over the next several months, because what Joe said earlier about communication and understanding, I happen to have my older son is here.
And I learned when I had a hearing impaired child that a lack of communication creates a lack of understanding. Just because you don't hear doesn't mean that it's important for you to have communication. So communication creates understanding. You don't, you can't get involved with ideas and philosophies without communicating with people and understanding what's going on. Next question, please. Yes, sir.
I have two quick questions. Being a former Washingtonian, I was very involved with the where I think this country went off the rails, and that is the Roe v. Wade decision. What is your stand on abortion? And the second is, what do you feel about the ceiling increase?
Well, hold on. I'm so sorry, Craig. If you'd like to ask a question, hold until you have the microphone, because that way everybody can hear your question. So, if you want to answer Larry's, and Frank has the next question, and then Esther.
Okay. He asked about Roe v. Wade, where I am on conservative social issues. I am a very pro-life. I was raised Roman Catholic. I believe it undermines the fabric and of our nation.
All right.
When unborn children are not able to live. And I will be a strong supporter of the pro-life agenda. I was up at the National Right to Life Convention this past week with my friend Herman Cain. That reminds me, Joe, if Herman hasn't been here yet, Herman's a close friend of mine, I'd be happy to bring Herman Cain to visit here in Sarasota. And he asked about the current debt ceiling. I know that's on people's mind. This is not something new. This is what I was referring to as a contrived crisis. Everybody knows that our debt has been increasing and increasing and increasing. We have a unique opportunity right now. I think the Republicans need to stand firm. We need to send a strong message to our government that enough is enough. We will not default on our debt. We can't default on our debt. I've been in business long enough to know that if you don't meet your commitments, there's consequences associated with that. But we need to get this stopped. And I believe people like New Congressman Webster and others will have solutions to make this this crisis disappear. And we have to stay firm, because it's a unique time in history. It's a unique time and a unique opportunity. If we allow this to get passed, we may not get back to where we need to be nearly as quickly as we should. So I'm very supportive of standing firm. Yes, sir.
Hi, Craig. I met you earlier tonight. You were getting ready in the other room. And my question is, I'm an Air Force Vietnam veteran. I've had three Agent Orange evaluations at St. Pete and at Bay Pines.
Can you talk about this a little bit? I don't know whether it's my hearing or I can't quite hear.
I'm an Air Force Vietnam veteran.
Thank you.
I've had three Agent Orange evaluations over at Bay Pines. And when I'm talking to the physician's assistants over there, they do not pay attention to anything we talk to them about. And they write whatever they feel like writing in the evaluation. And I was smart enough to get a copy of the evaluation last Saturday. And 80% of what he put in my evaluation was incorrect. And it's really a shame. I'm an Air Force Vietnam veteran, and I have to have other people speak for myself when I can't speak. And as a senator, you make sure that us Vietnam veterans get treated with dignity instead of being treated like a second-class citizen. After 41 years, we're tired of it. Thank you.
First of all, thank you for your service. As you know, I was also an Air Force veteran. I spent a year at Cam Ranh Bay Air Force Base in South Vietnam. We owe our veterans a special nod. We owe our veterans to live up to the obligations that we have and the contracts we've made with them. You will not find a better advocate. The other thing about my life's history, or one of the things I've done, is I did fight in an unpopular war. We can never again allow that attitude to permeate in our country. And we need to do everything we can to get returning veterans jobs. We need to make sure that their homes are not disrupted. And it's nothing more than a thank you for the service they've given to our nation, and we owe them that.
I have a question.
We need to get the microphone.
Hold it closer.
My question, I'm very happy to hear that you're pro-life. But will you also vote against Planned Parenthood? That's my first question.
Well, you know, funding for Planned Parenthood is a priority that would be lower on my list of priorities, that's for sure. I am not a proponent of the federal government getting involved in the practice that leads to anything associated with the unborn child. I'm a pro-life Republican, and any time that issue is presented to me in a position that I have the ability to influence the decision, either through my vote or my views, you can always find me on the side of the unborn child.
Thank you.